Hello, I'm Robert Hooks, and welcome to the Roundtable. It's going to be a cliche, I know, but my next guest needs no introduction. All I have to do is say Della Reese. Della, welcome, my dear.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, how wonderful it is to
and
have
to see you
here.
Again. I haven't seen you for such a long time.
I know. I got to tell you that my son Kevin, who, you know, we all go back because he started so young. I talked to him this morning and told him I was coming to talk with you. And he sends you his love.
Yes.
And I know you send it back.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. We did some wonderful things together, you and I.
Absolutely. We grew up together.
We did. In this business.
Yeah.
I recall, and I mentioned to you earlier, it's always nice to see the young people do their thing. We did, I guess it was a Bold Ones. I'm not sure. Bold Ones? Maybe it was a Bold Ones. And the young guy who played my son, and I think probably, Eric Lonneville.
Yes.
Who turns out to be a wonderful young director.
It's good to see. It's good to see that we were there when they started.
Yes. And to see them.
See them bloom is wonderful. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Well, I first of all, I'd like to talk to you about the church.
Yes.
I'd like to talk to you about the church.
I'd like to talk about that.
Well, I know you do because it's a different kind of church.
It is.
Talk to our audience
about
that.
Well, what happened was, I'll give you a little background. What happened was my brain exploded, and I had an aneurysm to rupture in my brain.
My.
And they decided that I was doing Johnny Carson's show at the time. Mm. And they decided that I should be dead before dawn. And I had been taking some classes before this happened. And as I didn't know what was wrong with me, but as I was falling, I said, "Into your hands I commit my spirit."
Mm.
And then I was out for 3 days.
3 days.
Absolutely. And they first took me across the street from Johnny Carson's show.
Mm-hmm.
There was a hospital. And they looked at me and they decided that it was my size that was giving me a heart attack. And then they examined me. I didn't have a heart attack.
Mm-hmm.
So they didn't know what was wrong with me. So they shipped me to another hospital.
Right.
And when I got there, they decided I was black and I was an entertainer. And I probably had overdosed on some drugs. So they kept looking for that. They couldn't find that. So they finally called my doctor, and he came in and he said, I treat this lady, and she is not a drug addict, and there's something else wrong with her.
Mm-hmm.
And he began to examine me, and he discovered that this aneurysm had ruptured in my brain. And he started tests and things. And that hospital, nobody wanted to be responsible for Della Reese dying in their hospital. So they shipped me to another hospital.
The third hospital?
The third hospital. And when I got there, they brought me what was supposed to be the best doctor in the West.
Mm.
And he came to my room every day and explained to me why I had to die. And he had statistics, you know, 4 out of 7 and 5 out of 9, whatever. And the lessons that I had learned just kicked into play.
Mm-hmm.
And the things that I had learned just kept sustaining me and I kept not being afraid of going to die.
Yeah.
And it was right here. So blood being a circulatory thing, it must have ran down, come down, stop right here,
mm-hmm.
and ran down, come back, and stop right here for 2 weeks. Well,
wow.
Now when I got up, I said, "I got to run and tell everybody about this, because this cannot be," you see. And so I went, they took me to Canada to this marvelous doctor, Drake, who trained most of the young men who are working with aneurysms and brain conditions mm-hmm. and things in the world.
Mm.
And he operated. And when he opened it up, he found that on the other side, there were two others that were about to rupture.
Oh,
and so he closed it. And then 10 days later, he went back and fixed the other two. And then 10 days later, I was doing a commercial for Campbell Soup. Now I got to tell everybody. I got to tell it to everybody.
Right.
But that old hymn said, I said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul, but I had to tell it. And so I started taking some more lessons.
Mm-hmm.
And I got very involved. And you know, when it's happened to you and you've used it and it worked for you, you have more understanding and more power for it. They call it new thought, but it's not really new thought. It's what Jesus taught. Mm-hmm. It's that you are in control of you, that there's a piece of God inside of you.
The real
and if
God.
You will get in yeah. touch with that, right. you are greater, a bigger, I don't mean from an egotistical point mm-hmm. of view, but you're stronger than whatever happens to you. And you can control it because life itself is a matter of mind over matter. Right. And if your mind is assured that you are powerful, then you can handle whatever happens to you. And so I began to do classes here in the house. Mm-hmm. And my husband was so wonderful. Mm-hmm. But we started off with 8 people, and we have 80 sitting in this room right
oh
here.
My.
He can't go to the kitchen without getting fully dressed. So, well, you know when your mate is tired of that. You understand?
Yeah.
And I'm very much in love with him.
Frank is a good man.
Absolutely. So I started teaching outside. Right. And we found places where we could have classes. And one of the ladies who was coming to the class, her husband, they told him he had terminal cancer. Mm. And they had been married for 35 years, but he became very angry. And most of the anger was at her. She hadn't done anything wrong. Mm-hmm. The sickness was making
sure.
him angry with her. And so she brought him here. He didn't want to know. He didn't want to hear. But she just kept bringing him and bringing him. And for 6 months, he came. Mm-hmm. And you could see the change in him when he got some information.
Yes.
When he understood what he was capable mm-hmm. of doing. And he began to be a different person. And nicer. Mm-hmm. They went back to courting.
Mm.
It was a loving thing to see them. And eventually, he did succumb to the cancer. And right. so she wanted me to do the service for mm-hmm. him. And she wanted it to be a celebration. So I went to do the service. And the minister would not let me in the pulpit. I had to stand on the floor mm. to do what I was doing. And I did what I do. And when I finished, he said, and the people stopped crying, mm-hmm. and they would begin to get an understanding. And when I finished, the minister said, well, she said some nice things, those are cute words, but all y'all gonna be laying here eventually, and you better try to get yourself ready. Well, now they start crying all over
again. Oh, my goodness. Gotta get out of that church.
So yeah. the lady whose husband it was asked the minister, please don't come to the cemetery.
Right.
And she asked me
yeah.
if I would go to the cemetery and see that he was laid away
uh-huh.
properly. And so that was one of the things. The other thing was, there was a couple who wanted to get married, but they didn't want to say until death do us part. They wanted to say for as long as we live.
Sure.
I couldn't see any difference in the two.
Right.
And so I finished the service, and she wanted her pastor to give the benediction. So he got up
mm-hmm.
and he said, well, don't you want to live with this man until you die?
Oh, please.
She said, well, that's in the middle of the wedding, we're now discussing
yeah.
whether she wants to live with him. So I decided to go back to school and right. get a license so that I could be a minister.
Mm-hmm.
And I spent 8 years to get a degree and started to work.
How wonderful. What a great story,
yes.
too. I mean, an inspiring story. Because I believe that so wholeheartedly,
yes.
that God is within
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely.
We can do whatever, we can praise to whoever, but the real God, the
Absolutely.
God that steers your life and
Absolutely.
Your emotions is inside.
When he rested 6 days, he worked, and the seventh day he rested.
Right.
Well, that's where he rested, in me and you.
That's right.
You see, that's where he is, you see. And we don't know how to go in and get it and use it.
Mm-hmm.
We are trained to give into circumstances and situations and confusion and all of those things.
And that's why they come to you.
Absolutely.
Your church.
Come to learn.
Now, get the title of your church.
Understanding Principles for Better Living.
It's wonderful.
It's the truth.
It
if
is
you
so
understand
wonderful.
The principles that God has left here for us, your life must become better.
It says everything. I mean, that's really what it's all about.
Yes, it is.
And like you said about the guy who eventually passed from cancer, he learned
he did.
The principles all over
Absolutely.
Again.
Absolutely. And he was happy. He,
yeah.
he when he came in, he was like, but when he was just light and happy. And
right.
you see, because we all are just passing through
sure,
here, you know.
Sure.
We are, it's how you go, how you feel about going. you see. And he came to a place where he was very happy with his life and the life that he had had with his wife.
Right.
And he was ready to go.
But to touch people's lives like you are doing.
It's wonderful.
Oh, my,
it's
my,
wonderful.
My. Now tell me something, a question that I have, because my wife said to me, agape came up.
Yes.
Now, were you involved in the agape church as well?
No, I'm aware of that church, and I'm friends with the minister of that church. But I definitely teach. I'm a Bible-based New Thought church, and people get confused with the phrase New Thought because they think it's a cult or they don't have any understanding about what it really is. But Jesus Christ came to show us how to have life, and that more abundantly. Mm-hmm. When they ask him, why are you here? Mm-hmm. He said, I have come that they may have life and that more abundantly. And the way you have the abundance in life is to know your relationship, your personal relationship with God, you see. Mm-hmm. And to live by the laws of God, not just be burdened down with him, because Jesus kept saying, I'm doing this so your joy will be full.
Uh-huh.
I'm doing this so you'll be happy. Yeah. And this is what I come to tell you where the goodies are. This is how you get to the goodies.
Right.
You see.
Now, you are now based in the Methodist church in Inglewood.
Now, I'm in Inglewood. I'm in a Methodist church. I'm sharing
That's
the
what I was going to ask. Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. So you're sharing. That's your home now.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Tell us now about this Christmas special that you're going to be doing. That's going to have a lot of my friends. And, of course, you know, you and I are two of the oldest friends in this business.
Well, I remember Christmas as a child. And the people in our age bracket, as we were talking before we got on camera, Christmas was an entirely different thing. Our parents didn't have a lot of money.
Right.
My father poured steel, and he did it for 37 years. And when they found out he was 75 and let him go, they got a machine because they said the work that he did was not meant for a human being. So money was very important. My mother scrubbed floors and cleaned houses to help my father meet the things necessary. And he didn't see any sense at all in buying a tree that you were going to burn up in 2 days. He wouldn't spend his money on that, you see. And if he bought me something, it was the winter coat that I needed. I'm born in Detroit, Michigan.
Oh, yeah.
And
you need a winter coat.
Or it was the shoes, the boots that I needed, not toys and things like that. Christmas for us was, my mother was an excellent cook, and she would cook what everybody liked, what my brother liked. So there would be a couple of cakes. My brother liked the chocolate cake. I liked the coconut cake. My father liked the pound cake. So we had cake, you see. And she would cook all the things that we liked. And so for 3 or 4 days, we would rewarm it and eat that. And that was all of Christmas. But what it did to me, it made me miss Christmas. So when my daughter was born, I was determined that the Christmas I never had, she would have. And so I was busy decorating boxes and buying her everything I could think to buy her. And the biggest tree in captivity. And all the tinsel and the bells and the balls and the bowls. So I did that for 40 years. And then my grandson was born. And so now I can't be any better to her than I am to him, because I adore him. So here I am.
Other generation.
Absolutely.
So those are the kinds of stories.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, I won't be able to be there, unfortunately. Yes. And I would if I could, but I'm going to have to be somewhere else. But my Christmas story, one of my Christmas stories, and I related it to you early on, when my brother Jimmy, who we're 2 years apart, for Christmas, every Christmas, we'd get, because we wore them out by the next Christmas, we had I would get the cowboy hat and the stick horse, and he would get the boots and the six guns, and every other day we'd switch off, and I'd be a full cowboy, and the next day he'd be a full cowboy, and that's the way we celebrated our Christmases.
That was what they could afford.
Yes.
They did the best they could with what they had.
These are some of the stories that your guests will be telling.
Yes.
What else is going to be happening
Well, afterwards, we're going to have ballroom dancing. Yes, where you dance with close to your partner. I don't like the dancing where daddy's over there and I'm over here.
Yeah, ballroom.
I want to be up in his arm. And
when have we done that lately?
Oh, it's going to be wonderful.
That's great. Ballroom dancing.
And we're going to have hors d'oeuvres and refreshments and things after. We're having the spiritual entertainment first, and then we're having the ballroom dancing.
Spiritual entertainment, mm-hmm. Gospel choir.
Gospel choir. Yeah. Lou Gossett's going to come.
Who's coming?
And tell his story. I brought you a flyer, so even though you can't be there, you can see who's going to be there.
We'll put this up, won't we, Milton? Yes, we'll put this on.
Kalita Smith, who was with Matt.
Yes. Bernie Mac. Yes, wonderful actress.
Hattie Winston, who was with Becker.
And who also goes all the way back to the group theater workshop with me.
Absolutely.
The 60s.
Absolutely.
Hattie Winston.
And we're going to have Yolanda Watts. Mm. And we're having Nick Latour.
Oh, my.
Is going to sing for us.
Well, you're going to have some serious singing.
I got the baddest choir in town. They mm-hmm. just break down and just do it to pieces and back together again. And Leo...
From
the 7 o'clock Channel 7 News.
Oh. His name's on here.
Yes, it is.
His name's on here. Leo Stallworth.
Yes, that's his name. Yes. He's going to be there, and he's going to tell his story. And in between each story, and then we're going to start with a child. I have a young lady who is a dancer. She's about 12 years old, and she came here dancing. She brought it with her. You know, she takes some lessons, but she doesn't really need it. She brought it with her when she came, and she's going to open so we can have the first child of the show, and then we're going to go on with all these people. It's going to be a wonderful evening.
How does the viewers are going to be watching this show before the event? How do they participate? The viewers, our viewers.
Oh, you're welcome to come.
That's what I'm saying.
We have tickets for sale, and you're welcome to come. It's an open house, and there's room for everybody, and it's going to be something you don't want to miss because you're going to get, not only are you going to get the stories, but in these stories, I just told you my story.
Right.
So even though you knew me before, now you know me better.
Oh, yes, indeed.
You see, and you're going to get to intimately know the people who are being involved in this show. They're not just going to be somebody on the screen that you see. These are going to be people when you walk away, you're going to say, I didn't know she did that.
It's funny because I was just going to say, when you were talking about your mother being a great cook, as was my mother, and that table at Christmas time, when, I mean, every vegetable you can imagine. But the cakes, and I remember my mother's chocolate cake, coconut cake, but then my mother would make, and this is amazing, I tried it once and it didn't work, she would make half of a pineapple and coconut cake and half of a chocolate cake. One cake, but half and half.
Half and half.
She did it, and nobody could ever do it again.
See?
That's the
wonderfulness. That's something to, you know, people... speak about being poor, and it is, rich is better, trust me, okay? but there are some things you get when you don't have everything you want already.
Yes.
There are some things that I carry with me from my mother. My mother, we had this ugly green chair. The ugliest green chair ever made. I don't care who makes chairs. And it was where my father, after work, would read the newspaper. Now, he wouldn't read the newspaper, but he would hold it up and he would nap behind the newspaper, okay, after dinner. Uh-huh. And my mother, that was where she spoke to God, in this chair. And I have seen her. That's another thing that made me want to do this. I have seen her. There'd be no money. My mother was Cherokee, and she felt that if you ask anybody for anything, you were saying that your husband was not capable of taking care of you.
Wow.
Now, she was a giver, but she never borrowed anything from anybody. And I saw her sit in the chair and talk to God with her legs crossed in that yoga position, Indian position. And she talked to him just like I'm talking to you.
Wow.
And she would say, Father, it's Wednesday, and I have enough food to make the lunch for the baby, that's me, and for Rich. But I don't have any bread, and I really do need some bread, and I'd appreciate it if you would send me some bread so I can, because they can't go to work without, he can't go to work with nothing to eat.
Right.
And she got to go to school, and she can't go to school with nothing to eat. Right. And I, would you please send me some bread? Right. All right, now, we lived in an apartment building. Mm-hmm. No refrigerators, ice boxes. Okay.
Right.
Somebody would knock on the door, this is the truth, and say, Miss Nellie, I bought a loaf of bread. And my sister bought a loaf of bread. And I ain't got nowhere to put all this bread. Would you do me a favor and take a loaf of this bread?
Sitting and talking to Jesus.
I thought she was a witch.
Wait a minute. How did she?
How did she do that? But it made me have a true understanding that I had some kind of a relationship with God, which really helped me through the years that I was out there entertaining on the road all the time.
Yes.
I didn't have to do things.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have to have drugs. I didn't have to sleep with everybody to get a gig.
Right.
I didn't have to do that. I knew to get in a chair somewhere.
And do some talking.
Absolutely.
Yes. You talk about the entertainment industry. I want to touch, just take us back for a minute, because your longevity is just unbelievable.
It's
wonderful. You have been here for as long as you've been here, but you have done so much.
Yes.
You've done so much. What was it like in the early days? You touched on it just a little bit just now. And through the, you sang, you were a great singer, with all the albums and stuff. And then you started acting. And that surprised me. I said, wait a minute, that's Della Reese. She's out there acting like you wouldn't believe, right? And then you're writing books, and you become a minister. You're in the ministry. That's a lot in your life.
Yes, but you have the right to all of that in your life.
Mm.
You don't have to get stuck into something and never get out of that. What the kind of music that I sang is not applicable
mm-hmm.
at this time. They want something else.
Yes.
You see, but I have this wondrousness that when I sang, people sat down and listened mm-hmm. to me. And if somebody said something, the audience would turn around and say, will you hush? Now everybody's working. The singer's working. The audience is dancing.
Talking to the singers.
I wouldn't have lasted 10 minutes.
Right.
You see, because when I came up, it was understood that if you were a black woman, what you did was you shook your fanny and you sang and you dressed as naked as possible, and that was the way you showed yourself.
Right.
So I was determined that I was never going to dress like that,
mm-hmm.
and I wasn't going to move. I was going to stand, and I was going to sing, and my voice was going to reach you, and that was that,
mm-hmm.
you see? And I'm very blessed. I have that wonderful memory of people listening to me, of people being touched by what I was singing. Now, it's a different kind of music now, and I'm not knocking it.
No,
it's,
I know.
It's not my, but it's not what I want to do.
It's funny.
You see?
It's funny. I was going through the television looking for the football game the other morning, Saturday morning, and all of a sudden there you were singing a Duke Ellington tune. It don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing on.
That's so Raven. Absolutely.
So I wanted to just kind of back up for a second, because your life has been so incredible and so uplifting for so many people in the industry. When did you start acting? I mean, I know you were singing.
How did
that happen?
I would be on a job in Chillicothe, Ohio. Not to put down Chillicothe, but that's
Nancy Wilson's hometown,
which was so far from the big mainstream of things. And I would see people on television that I knew if I was sound asleep, I could do what they were doing better than they were doing that, you know?
Right.
And I said, well, I can do that. And I want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to be with my child. I was tired of running up and down the road.
Right.
And so I said, well, I'll do that. And so I came and I took anything that I could get.
Right.
You remember they used to have the lady who ran the ice house, and all the detectives came in there, and she was the lady who ran it, and she would sing a song, but she would get a chance to say two or three lines.
I
took that. I took little bitty parts and learned as I was doing it, and worked myself into being accepted as an actress. I did whatever I could get.
Sure.
To train, as you did.
Yes,
you know,
of
you
course.
Took what you yeah. could do much better things than you had to do, but you took what was available
right,
until people recognized you mm-hmm. and allowed you to do that. Well, I did that. And then after a while, I needed something else. And I got touched by an angel
yes.
for 9 years,
yes.
and I did that. And my husband kept saying, what you just said, mm-hmm. you need to write some of the things down that you have done. And I had never written a book before, mm-hmm. but when I got to writing it, it was like therapy
sure.
to remember all the things that I had gone through. Mm-hmm. I hadn't thought about it before, but Sammy Davis Jr., Lena Horne, mm-hmm. Billy Daniels, Billy Eckstein, mm-hmm. Myself, Sarah, Ella, we could go to Vegas and we could work in Vegas, but we couldn't eat in there. Mm-hmm. We couldn't sleep in there. Mm. We couldn't go to the bathroom in there.
Wow.
You had to go backstage to go. And as soon as you were finished, you had to get off of the property.
Mm.
And I hadn't thought about that because I was so glad it was over.
Sure.
Tell you a story. I did the Sullivan Show. And I did it 17 times in a year because the Autumn Concerto was his love song to Mrs. Sullivan. And I did an adaptation of that called And That Reminds Me. Uh-huh. So every time he wanted, you know, there was a time you couldn't speak to anybody on television.
Right.
You couldn't
right.
speak through the television to anybody mm-hmm. or you couldn't dedicate anything to anybody. So what he would do, he would have me come on and sing And That Reminds Me mm-hmm. to his wife because he loved to tell her that for
right.
her birthday, for
right.
Christmas, uh-huh. whatever.
So you were just up there singing it.
Up there singing.
That's
17
great.
Times in a year. So he took me with him to Vegas. And there's a place called the Dust Bowl,
mm-hmm.
Way on the other side, and it was named right. There wasn't mm-hmm. a piece of cement
just
over there anywhere.
Bowl.
It was just a dusty
right.
place. And Dr. West and his wife built some houses so that we, the black entertainers, would have some place to stay.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm late getting there, and I get there, and I haven't had anything to eat. And so I didn't think about it. I picked up the phone and ordered a hamburger. And the hamburger didn't come. Mm-hmm. I'm the opening act, so I go on and I do what I'm supposed to do. And when I come back, I call again and say, you know, I ordered a hamburger, and the hamburger didn't come. Well, now it's 11:45, and the hamburger still hasn't come.
Hamburger.
And I'm sharing a dressing room with Blossom Deary.
Deary, yes, yes.
And Blossom is having a fit. She's walking up and down the hall backstage, and she said, it's a damn shame.
Yeah.
This child is hungry, and she can't get something to eat. And Mr. Sullivan came back and asked, what is wrong with you, Blossom? She said, it just doesn't make sense.
Mm.
When she came here, she ordered a hamburger, and they won't give her anything to eat. How can she work
right.
with nothing to eat? He said, just a moment. And he goes to the telephone,
mm-hmm.
and he picks up the phone, and he says, this is Ed Sullivan. And he's got the phone where I can hear what they're saying.
Right, right.
And he says, Miss Reese ordered a hamburger, and I don't understand why Miss Reese doesn't have the hamburger.
Right.
And we get it right there, right away. And so he's, just a minute, what do you want on your hamburger? Well, I'm hungry. I don't care what they
right.
put on you. Just bring that. He said, no, tell mm-hmm. me what. So I told him whatever it was that
right.
I wanted on the
right.
hamburger. The hamburger got there almost before he hung up. I'm grateful. So I'm eating and I'm just chugging it down because it's 15 minutes to 12.
Sure.
The show goes on at 12 and I got to open.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, no. If they'd have brought the hamburger, you'd be through eating by now.
Mm.
So just take your time.
Take your time.
So he held up the show.
Good old Ed.
Huh? Yum. Until I got through eating. And every night after that, he took me on the strip to one of the fabulous restaurants, sat me down in the middle of the room.
Mm.
People got up and mm-hmm. walked out because I was in there and I
right.
was black and they
right.
didn't want
yeah.
to be in the room with me. But all the while I was there, he took me and gave me food and gave me some dignity,
mm-hmm.
you see. And I hadn't thought about that. So when I was writing the book, I had a chance to experience
sure.
that all over again. And I found out I liked writing.
Sure.
I didn't know that before then. And so there I said, I'll write some more.
Recall some more.
Yeah,
that's great. I'm going through the same thing. As a matter of fact, right now I'm writing my autobiography, and it is so wonderful to go back and just relive those wonderful things. And like you said, you know, a lot of people, when they read it, a lot of people say, oh, wow, I didn't realize that that happened to him or happened to her. What are your thoughts, because you are a veteran, you've been in this business for a long time. I'd like to touch on with you image, the image of black folk on the screen and on the big screen and the little screen. What are your thoughts about where we've come to, or have we come far enough?
Well, no, we haven't come far enough, but we've come a great distance. But my problem is we left some stuff. You know, there was a time that there were things that we as black people would not do. We just wouldn't do that, you see. No matter what they did to us, we wouldn't do that. We've left that. I wanted us to keep that. I wanted us to have that dignity. I wanted us to have that respect for ourselves. I wanted us to continue to be that strong, not to give in order to get what it was that we wanted to do. We have some very talented young people, and I'm thinking that the generation is changing, and our young people are trying to get back what we had that brought us through.
Yes. I'm feeling that, too. I'm feeling that, too. It's always nice to hear, you know, to hear people like ourselves that have gone through all of the things that we've gone through. Some not so good, some wonderful.
But all of it made us stronger.
Indeed. The decade of the 60s, when everybody talked about, you know, the revolution, everybody talked about the war, the Vietnam protests. The decade of the 60s, as an actor, as a cultural person, was the most incredible decade for me.
Absolutely.
Right? 70s, 80s, 90s, but the 60s were people, you know. So I can go back and recall all of that. Yeah, that's amazing. So now, are you still, I saw you recently, as I said, on That's So Raven, but the acting is still there. You're going to be doing
I'm doing everything. I like to do a lot of stuff.
Right.
You know, I like to be excited by things. I just finished a movie, Looking for Mary, which is going to be, probably won't be on this Christmas, but will be on next Christmas. And I enjoyed doing, I hadn't had a part for quite a while, and I enjoyed doing that. I thought I was satisfied with just being at the church and not singing. And then one of the members of the church asked me to go to her hometown and sing at the college there. And I didn't know how much I had missed it.
Wow.
It thrilled me. It just absolutely thrilled me to my soul. And I know that I got to do that.
Yeah.
I've got to do some more of that. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, absolutely.
And I need to do that.
Well, I tell you, I'm sitting there watching you on television the other day, and not only were you singing, it don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. You were scatting.
Yes.
I mean, you were doing some serious scatting. I said, wait a minute. I haven't heard scatting
on
any of those shows.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But there you were up there scatting, and that young girl, Raven, she is just so
adorable.
Sweet.
Just adorable.
And the love that they showed for you.
Yes.
Was just so wonderful.
Yes.
And I mean, you know, it's just amazing to see that you still have your chops.
Yes.
Because you can sing it. You were singing it, right?
Yes.
And they would
I sing at the church, but you know, when I was entertaining, I did an hour and a half, an hour and 45 minutes twice a night, you know? And I sing a song in the church on Sunday, and I really thought that was okay with me. But I went and did this job in Florida, and I felt so good. I just had to accept that I need to sing. I need to sing. I need for you to hear it if you want it, but I need to sing.
You need to sing. I love where your spirit is. Your spirit is so high, it's almost coming through the top of your head.
Good.
And it's a wonderful thing to see. I mean, I practice it myself. I don't believe, I think every time you get up in the morning, your spirit has to be in the right place.
Absolutely.
And to get through the day, you will never see any negative thing coming out from me.
No.
And I know from you as well, because I know you that well.
How blessed you are to get up in the morning.
Indeed.
Now, to be able to get up under your own power, brush your own teeth.
Yes.
Comb your own hair. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? No matter what else happens all day long, you're a winner.
No question.
Yes.
I want to go back now.
Yes.
I want to go back to talk about the event. Christmas. I remember my Christmas as a child.
Yes.
And talk a little bit more about our audience coming and getting tickets. Is it online? Can they get you online?
They can call the office.
I want to just say the church where it's going to be. It's the First Lutheran Church at 600 Queen Street in Inglewood. I know the area well.
And that's very important to me. Mm-hmm. I have had the church all over. This is the most mobile church in captivity. Mm. We have been all over. And it's such a pleasure for me to finally get a spot in Inglewood where my people are, where I can be in touch with them. I so want to share this knowledge of how you can do better with the people that I love, with the people that are important.
Sure.
And not that all people aren't important to me. I don't mean that.
No, I understand.
But I've been in Hollywood. I've been in Beverly Hills. I've been, and to be in Inglewood is important to me. Because the people I've been there a year, and they're become the neighborhood people are beginning to come in, and I can see them saying, "Oh, I didn't know you could do it like that."
Right? See?
I didn't
see?
Look at that.
It's wonderful.
Yes.
It's a new age in religion and spirituality. It's a new age, and you're leading it. You're leading it. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. And I don't think you'll ever be interviewed. This is an Inglewood show. This show is an Inglewood. The Urban Roundtable is an Inglewood show.
Wonderful.
And our executive producer, Milton R.F. Brown, has been working at this, and Congresswoman Judy Dunlap, Councilwoman, forgive me, I just elevated her.
That's good.
Judy Dunlap. And they have been responsible for making this Urban Roundtable show
wonderful.
What it is.
Wonderful.
And the people of Inglewood really and truly love the show. So this is, you'll be interviewed a lot
wonderful.
On television, but
wonderful.
I think this will be the
well,
only
that's wonderful.
Inglewood
I'm glad
show.
I got an opportunity to do this.
Absolutely. And incidentally, speaking about Inglewood and how it's so nice to be able to sit down and talk with you on Inglewood television, Inglewood has now come to you, my dear.
Oh.
Councilwoman Judy Dunlap.
Hello, Judy.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you for inviting us into your beautiful home.
Thank you for coming.
Now, what are you holding there?
We have a resolution from the city of Inglewood that I'd like to present to you, if I may.
Thank you.
Let me read it, because it has some of your, just a few of your many, many accomplishments. We're welcoming you to the city of Inglewood. Whereas Della Reese has contributed over 50 years of exceptional talent and a career that includes feature films, television, stage, guest performances, symphony engagements, recordings, vocalist, songwriter, author. And whereas Della Reese was the first African-American to host her own talk show, syndicated nationally by RKO in 1969-1970. And whereas Ms. Reese received three Emmy nominations for her role as Tess in the CBS dramatic series Touched by an Angel, and was honored by Legacies of Women in the Performing Arts, and was among those honored at the Oprah Winfrey Legends Ball. And whereas Della Reese has been nominated for three Grammy Awards, a 1960 Best Female Vocalist, 1987 Best Female Gospel Soloist, 1988 Best Traditional Gospel Album, and I was there to see you receive that, so
wonderful.
I feel so special. I received five NAACP Image Awards for Best Actress in Touched by an Angel, 1996 to 2000, the 1994 Living Legends Award for Soul of American Music, the Golden Globe Award for Best Actress, Supporting Role in Touched by an Angel, the 1989 Dove Award for Best Traditional Gospel Album, designated the 1998 Woman of Achievement by Ladies Home Journal, and in 1994 received her star in the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
My goodness gracious.
Is the show going to be long enough, Robert?
Is there more?
There's more.
Okay, read it, because I'm enjoying this.
All right. Whereas Della Reese received her doctorate from the University of Metaphysics and was ordained a minister, and for 27 years she has enriched the lives of the members of her Understanding Principles for Better Living Church, UP Church. And whereas the UP Church is an essential part of the City of Inglewood's goals toward advancing community pride and supporting resources which promote education, the economy, and health. And whereas Della Reese continues to captivate her audiences through her current Grammy-nominated gospel CD, Alive, My Soul Feels Better Right Now, as well as her inspirational CD entitled Give It to God. And now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of the City of Inglewood seeks to highlight the work of this extraordinary woman and her legacy, and to embrace Della Reese as a member of the Inglewood family. Ms. Reese, we welcome you with open arms and take great pride in the significant difference you are making in our community.
Oh, that's wonderful. I love that. I love that. I love that. I love that. I love that.
Can you get that?
Can you get that? Please get that.
That's great. And what a wonderful dramatic reading.
Yeah.
Show off. You show off, you.
Oh, good.
That's
good.
Great. That's wonderful.
Good.
We are so happy to have you and all that you are about and all that you bring to our city. And it's just you have us, there's so much positive about your entire nature, your persona, everything. And it's just, you're just like a gift.
Well, I'm very happy to be accepted there. I'm enjoying it. We're getting along well, and the people of Inglewood have begun to come in the church. I brought with me an audience, but we're integrating with the people in Inglewood, and I'm enjoying that very much.
Well, I think as more and more people learn that you have your church there, that they will begin to come,
oh,
and
I know
they
it.
Will stay, of course.
I know it for sure. Mm-hmm. I know it for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And the special nature of the church. Mm-hmm. It's they won't experience anything like it in any other church.
And we have they should know, we have a lot of fun. I'm not going to tell you that you're no good. So how could you be made in the image likeness of God and be no good? Mm. I'm not going to tell you you're not going to make it. I come to tell you that God wants for you the very best of everything. And here's a way that you can go about getting what he wants you to have. You see? And how wonderful you are. And we have fun. We laugh. Mm-hmm. We have a good time. We enjoy serving God. And so please come and enjoy it with us.
It's a joyful place.
Yes, it is. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
There's going to be some joy on Saturday the 5th, too.
Oh, yes. We're going to have a ball.
Dancing, ballroom, dancing. Do you plan to come?
Yes, I do.
Wonderful.
You'll be there.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
The woman is serious.
All right. Yeah. We're going to have a good time. Mm-hmm.
Can you share with us some of the ideas that you have with regard to programs for young people? You know, we have a lot of, we had a lot of negative imagery with regard to the city on occasion, and our children always need help and positive role models and activities. So share with us something that you have planned to enhance their lives.
I'm very proud of our children because they won't have to unlearn all the things that you and I had to unlearn. They're learning from the very beginning how wonderful they are, how much talent they have, how many things they're capable of doing, how many doors are open for them, how much love that we feel for them, how much we need them, how much we appreciate them. And so they have an attitude. What really cracks me up is when the mother is doing something that is kind of not like she's teaching them to do, and they'll say to her, well, at the church they say that's not love, mother. They say that what you're doing is not love. And I threaten the mothers, don't you dare do anything to them because they told you the truth. So I'm very happy that they're wonderful people. One of the little girls who's about 8 years old stood up two Sundays ago. And we have a testimony service so you can boast about what God has done for you. And she stood up and she said, well, I just wanted everybody to know that God is very good to me. And I have a chance now to sing in the school Christmas program. And I'm going to sing, and she sang her whole part. that she's going to sing in the Christmas. And she was very proud of that. Mm-hmm. She was very happy to be doing that. And so we're also working with the Lutheran minister, Pastor Christian, because he has a school there within the church that's operating for the children, mm-hmm. and he's teaching. So there's a lot of activities. Last month, we took them to the museum, I'm going to call the name of it, to see the Noah's Ark exhibit. Mm. And they all enjoyed it, and they got some of the Bible. They got some fun to play with. We take them on picnics. We take them bowling. Mm. We take them out so that they have camaraderie with each other and also with the parents. We have Sunday school classes, but we start off with the children going to church with their parents. Mm. And when it's time for the sermon, the children go to Sunday school. And it's a wonderful thing to see because they are so glad to get out of there from those parents and they run upstairs. And they have lessons of various kinds. They have lessons, of course, from the Bible, but they have lessons and stories read to him. We have wonderful teachers who teach them things and take them places and become involved in their lives. So I think that's going to help. Mm-hmm. One day we had a young man to come in, just came in off of the street, and he said he didn't know what he was going to do because it seemed like things were trying to get in touch, get him and take him over. And the men of the church stood up and took him mm-hmm. into a meeting, and they talked to him. He had been out of school. He was afraid to go back to school because he was afraid that they were going to do something to him because he had skipped school for so long. They took him to school. They took him away from the home he was living in because it was not a proper place for him to be. And the men of the church did that. Mm-hmm. And so he had some male influence in his life. And they took him under their wings, and they're working with him. So we have good things going on. I think we will help the children.
Well, sometimes as a school teacher, I taught elementary school in the city of Inglewood for 25 years. Mm-hmm. It is that exactly what you're talking about, that individual attention. It's one child at a time. What can you do for that one child mm-hmm. at a time to build their self-esteem? Mm-hmm. Because that's really it's what makes the difference in their lives. Because otherwise, many of our young people do feel like they don't have a future or they need guidance. So I appreciate that, what you're doing with regard to the guidance that you're giving them.
Absolutely, absolutely. I like children better than I do adults. You know, they're fresh in mind. They're interested in doing things. They love life. They want to get involved in good things. And so I'm at my best with them, and I enjoy them. And I have some magnificent teachers who have studied and who know how, in a childlike way, with an adult attitude, to teach them how to be as strong as they can be.
Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. funny. Well, I see a great future in Inglewood with the principal, with the Up Church.
Yes.
Say the Up Church.
Yes. We call it the Up Church because the music is up, thy lessons are up, and when you leave the church, you will be uplifted.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. For the Up Church.
Yes.
I can't wait to get over there.
I want you there.
Yeah,
I want you there.
Well, I heard you say you're going to miss the program on Saturday.
I'm going to miss the program.
But we'll be there, and we'll see you another time.
Absolutely.
We'll go together and visit a church.
Wonderful. Great.
Well, listen, I just, needless to say, this has been a pleasure for me.
Mine.
Oh.
My
to
pleasure.
Be able to sit down and talk with one of my dear friends,
yes.
a true legend and icon in this industry, Della Reese, Reverend Dr. Della Reese. Thank you so much for coming on the Urban Roundtable.
I had a ball.
Thank you.